Right, and welcome to this first session of Berlin Buzzwords. I'm very happy to be the one to open this very first session. I'm Mr. Nick Benz. I'm from a company called Unix. And first of all, I have to be sorry to disappoint you, because in the program it says that I do big date applications, and I've really tried hard, but I'm not a big dating engineer. So if you came for that, I'm actually sorry, I can't give you that. But what I will tell you a little hunting story, because I will tell you how we were actually hunting and killing bugs in our big data projects that we did at 1&1. But now to start with something that you all know, this is the Hadoop elephant. He stands like no other animal for like big data, for the big data applications. And we all like him because he enables us to build really great programs that can process petabytes of data, you can scale out with him. So basically, if you have him, everybody is happy, all right? Everybody's happy, but then there is something that so we are all humans. If you are a coder, you know, if you write programs, you write bugs. And sometimes it's even more bugs, and it's a bad thing, of course, if you process petabytes, and the numbers that come out are just garbage, then you have a real problem, right? So there are bugs, or there may be bugs in these big data applications. So what do? If we don't want to have bugs, we have learned a lesson from software development. We do test-driven development, right? So we want to be able to write and execute tests. We want to specify acceptance criteria and so on. So this is what you do if you want to build software that has no or at least fewer bugs, all right? Now let's have a look at the big data crowd. Who can actually write tests and what languages do they speak? So the first guy in this crowd is the coder. I'm sure you know him. He's the one who knows all the Java classes, he knows how to write MapReduce code and so on, and he's into the nitty-gritty details of Hadoop and so on, and he talks his own language. He should be able to write and to execute tests. But he's not the only one. We also have the business engineer. He doesn't know so much about code. He knows more about money. He knows which KPIs are worth how much money. He should also be able to write tests, okay? It would be cool if he would also be able to produce good software, right? But still, he's not the only one. Then we have the data analyst. So he's also not so much into code, but he's more like into models, into statistics. And he knows all the models. And he also wants to be able to write tests. And finally, we have the hardware guy, the ops team. He runs the servers. He knows how to do everything smoothly on the hardware side. And now we also want to have him in the boat, right? And as you see, it's a really mixed crowd. And when you've ever built some kind of big data application, you will know that it's very crucial to a good application that they all work together quite well, okay? But this is now a bit difficult because they all speak different languages. They want to be able to write tests. And we want to report in this talk on a tool called Fitness, which we used in a project at 1&1 at a large-scale log-scale processing project to kind of unify all these languages in order to have some nice test-driven development in the big data field, and finally to hunt and to kill all the bugs, of course. All right, so in the next half an hour, I want to take you on a little road to big data QA, and those are the main steps. First of all, I will tell you a little bit about our big data problem at 1&1, and then I will tell you about Fitness, what Fitness is, how it works. And then finally, because what we do is actually data-driven, third part of the talk is about test data definition, test data selection, because it's a very important part, of course, as we are in the data-driven business. In the fourth part, I will show you how you can actually start Hadoop jobs, start Hadoop workflows using Fitness. And finally, because at the end of the day, you want to inspect results, you want to check if what you've done is right, I will show you some techniques to do result inspection. If there's any question in between, just raise your hand, don't worry. All right, so what have we done at this project at 1&1? We have done web intelligence. So basically, a core part of doing web intelligence is, or was in our case, log mining. So we are working on log data from an ad server, which does produce roughly 1 billion of log events per day, which is roughly 1 terabyte of raw data, which we process in our Hadoop clusters using several chains of MapReduce jobs running on 20 nodes. Each node has 8 cores. Each node has 96 gigabytes of RAM, and we're working on the CDH distribution of Hadoop. And what we actually produce is we do fill a data warehouse with numbers, which are the basis for several kinds of BI reporting, web analytics, and so on. So this is basically our setup that we're working with at one at one. I mean, so we don't process petabytes, but it's still a scale where Hadoop really already helps you a lot, right? Right, so I was telling you that we had those MapReduce chains, and now this is one such a typical chain. So we have some kind of input data. We have log files. In our case, those were log files from an ad server in the Thrift format. Then we have the first MapReduce job, which just produces a first intermediate result. Then we have the second job, which again does something with this result. And at the end, we write the really precious numbers then into a data warehouse. In our case, it was Oracle. And based on this data warehouse, we have then all those tools like MicroStrategy and so on, where we can build all those nice reports that you can give to your boss and make him pay a lot of money for what you do. All right, so now what is different? This is our setting. So what were the main challenges for doing test-driven development in such a setup? First of all, we had to be able to create sample input data. So when we started to develop this chain, the real ad server wasn't even online yet, so we didn't have real data. This is, well, because, and so we wanted to be able to, in a way, create sample log files in order to check if our jobs are doing the right thing, right? So this is what you really have to be able to do if you want to do this kind of test-driven thing. The next thing you have to be able to is you have to be able to inspect binary intermediate results. So if you've worked with Hadoop, you will know all those strange binary formats. In our case, we used Afro. And if you have some kind of intermediate result in this Afro format, as it's binary, you can't just have a look at the file. You need some means to check if the content of this file is right. Okay. And the third challenge was to, in a way, be able to control MapReduce workflow. So we had some kind of custom workflow engine at one at one, but we also wanted to be able to, let's say, run one single job or run two jobs. So we need some kind of workflow control, in the best case, integrated into our testing environment, right? And the fourth challenge is that all those guys should be able to test and to write tests, okay? So what to do? We first had a look at what is out there to do test-driven development. Well, of course, because it's finally all Java, there is JUnit as a natural candidate. JUnit tests isolated functions, which is okay. We also have those tests, but there is no kind of integration. And of course, if you want to write such a test, you have to be able to write Java, which Mr. Ackermann, I'm not sure if he's the Java pro, actually. Then there is an extension to JUnit called MRUnit, which tests one mapper against one reducer. It's already a bit more than plain JUnit, but it's still little integration, and still we have Java syntax, okay? Then there is one tool called iTest, which is part of the Apache BigTop project, which can be used to test complete Hadoop jobs or to test complete workflows. It's still a bit more, but still you have to be able to write Java or Groovy in order to write some kind of test, which is okay, but still I think Mr. Ackermann wouldn't be too happy. And finally, one thing which you can always do is you can write scripts, okay? So you can write bash scripts to call your jobs, you can check on your shell and do some kind of manual testing. That's all possible. But we were a bit thinking of some kind of a chaos with all those bash scripts, and still, I mean, bash syntax is also maybe something Mr. Ackermann isn't too familiar with. And finally, we had a look around, and we found one tool called Fitness, which we finally found to be a suitable addition and solution for our use case, which in a way fixes some of these issues of the other tools. All right, so in order to sum up this first step of the talk, one can say that Big Data QA is in a way, of course, different from what you do typically when you do usual software development. Now, let's go to the next step and see what's fitness. What can you do with fitness? Maybe just one question. Could you just raise your hand if you've ever written one kind of fitness test? Who has ever written a fitness test? 1, 2, 3, 4. OK, there is some few people. So if you have a look at the website, it says that the fitness is a fully integrated, standalone wiki and acceptance testing framework. This is like the official definition. In my eyes, I like to see fitness as a wiki where you can run the wiki pages. So you have a wiki, and on the wiki, you have a very simple syntax. You can write some kind of test, and there is a little run or a test button on each wiki page, and you can run directly in your browser those tests, all right? Now, one crucial point about fitness is that this leads to a almost natural language test specification. So people don't need to be able to write Java or Bash or whatever. They can almost write kind of test stories. And this is exactly what you need in the big data environment, because people hopefully speak natural language. Or basically, hopefully everybody speaks natural language. And from a technical point of view, the wiki is then connected to your system under test via so-called Java fixtures, which are just plain old Java objects. So to give you an overview about fitness, like it's basic architecture, as I said. So what you do is you basically have a built-in web server, and so you write the tests directly within your browser, within a very simple syntax. This is just a small example. I will give you a more detailed one later. So you write this really simple syntax, which is almost natural language. So you say, could you please check that the number of results is 3? Then you have the fitness server, which translates this page to Java calls, basically, in some kind of arbitrary Java class, which you can write on your own. And finally, from within this Java class, you can access your UAM system under test, finally. So if you want to put it in like a bit simpler words, it's like calling Java methods from a wiki directly, and you can compare what you get back. And the nice thing about fitness is that you cannot only click on this button test in your browser, but you can also call those tests from within Jenkins. It has a complete REST interface. This is also very neat if you don't want to click in your browser each time, but you can really automate the test, then run them nightly, and so on. So it's really nicely written by, I think the author is called Uncle Bob, and he really did a great job. All right, but now to start with a direct example. So what does such a fitness test look like? So here's a very simple test. Let's say we want to upload a file to HDFS, we want to run a certain Hadoop job, and we want to check if the number of output files is 3. And here we have the basic interface. As you see, it all runs in your browser. And so basically what you do when you write fitness tests is you write test tables. And here is such a test table. It's just written, or it's best read line by line. So it starts with a keyword script, which tells that there is now coming some kind of test series actions. And we want to have a script which tests some kind of Hadoop job. And then the next line, we tell the test to upload a certain file from our local hard drive to the HDFS into a certain remote directory. Then we start a Hadoop job from a particular jar with some input and some output. Then we show the job output directly on the wiki site. And finally, we check if the number of output files is 3. And this is actually the test story that I told you about. So this is no Java syntax. This is, it's supposed to be in a way that like everybody can write such a test using almost natural language. And one of the most important parts of this interface is, of course, the test button. So you can run this test directly by clicking this test button here. And if you run this test, then the outcome is being displayed directly on the page itself. And as you can see, line by line, the things are done. So first of all, the whole table is like instantiated. Then if this line here gets green, this means that the upload has been successful. If this line here gets green, it means that the job has run without errors. And finally, this green marker here tells us that this job actually has produced 3 output files, okay? And this is, of course, something that when everybody's happy, if you press test, everything is green, then it's all fine. And the good thing is, if you've written this test once, of course, you can change your code, run the test again, and finally be sure that your changes didn't break anything, okay? Now let's have a look at the source code of this test. So this was just the plain web interface. Let's have a look at the source code of this test. So we start with a path command. This path command tells fitness where to find those fixture classes which actually connect your test code to your actual system under test. So you have to do this once. You need one jar file with those fixtures, and you have to tell fitness where it is. Okay. And then the rest of the M syntax is also quite simple. You write those tables in this wiki-style table syntax. You say, okay, we start this little Hadoop script. We upload a certain file to the HDFS. Then we start this job from a certain jar file. We show the output on the website. And again, we check the number of output files. So as you see, it's very, very simple. You don't need to be a real, in a way, coder. You don't need to be a real data analyst or whatever. It's really thought in a way that everybody can write such a test, okay? And you can even do copy and paste from Excel if you like. There is a little helper method to, in a way, convert Excel to this one. And if you've ever done big data projects, I'm sure you will have been asked, how can I access this with Excel? Because Excel is, of course, still a big thing in many environments. All right, so this is like the source code of the test itself. Now let's have a look at an excerpt of the Java fixture class, which lies underneath this test. So it's, as I said, it's just a plain old Java class. So it's just a class which is called Hadoop. As you say, you have to mention this class name when you after this in the first line after this script check. And then the point about writing fixtures is that you write methods, and you can in a way call these methods from the wiki site itself. So you see this method upload to HDFS, which takes a local file and a remote file as some arguments. And if we go back, if you remember upload to HDFS, so in this line you basically call this method. So the method upload to HDFS is then called with these two arguments. Now the point is, if you are a coder, this will actually be horrible for you, because here you mix method names and arguments. This is what fitness does internally, but this is by intention, because this leads to, in a way, more natural test stories in a way. So maybe Mr. Ackermann would actually stand behind you when you write a test, and he would tell you, could you please upload this file to the HDFS at this destination? And this is actually what fitness does. By interpreting or splitting those method names, right? And the rest of the method calls is similar. You can just start some kind of Hadoop job, you can get the job output, and you can check the number of output files. And then within those methods, you can actually do whatever you want to call Hadoop jobs. You can access the Java interface for HDFS. So here now you have like the full Java control to connect to your system under test. All right, so to sum up this second step of our road, what we did is we did actually fitness wiki test execution, and yeah, we really had some kind of good results, because everybody can now write tests. Even right now at the 1&1, there is many business engineers writing tests in this very simple syntax. Right. So as I said, because we're finally in the data-driven business, it's very important to have good test data, because the quality of the test data finally determines the quality of the test. So how can we actually define test data? How can we write test data? So this is basically a wiki page from fitness, which just create a plain text CSV file. This is, it's not rocket science. You just have this symbol here that we start a table which just produce a log file. We specify where to store the log file, and the rest of this wiki page is just the plain raw data, which is then being written into this this certain log file, which is later the basis for the test which you're running, right? And so again, the syntax underneath is quite simple, so everybody should be able to in a way define these files. And once again, you can copy and paste from Excel. And so we have a very simple way to define small and very controlled log files. All right, so far about plain text. But in our case, the input data wasn't plain text. It's actually often the case that when you do some kind of big data application development, a very crucial point is that you have a very efficient and fast data transfer among heterogeneous sources. And one technique to do this is Thrift. So when you use Thrift, you define an interface via an interface definition language, and you have and you then take this IDL file and you compile it into different interface classes, for example, for Java, for C++, and so on. And so what do you do when you want to define not a plain text log file but a Thrift log file? So this is our Thrift log file fixture that we have written. So we just start again and say now we don't want to do a like normal log file, but we want to create a Thrift log file, right? Again, we say where to store it, and then as the second argument, we give the name of the Java class which has been compiled from the IDL. And the rest of this table is actually almost identical to the slide before. So here, now basically you can write your test data in, and the outcome is a log file in the Thrift format. Now you will say, well, this doesn't really look different from this table here. This is actually by intention, because this allows us to write log data basically transparently from the format. So from a test author point of view, he really doesn't care if he does produce CSV data or Thrift or whatever you need. You just have to change the header, right? And this is it's a very nice feature, because when you change your log input, for example, you just have to change the fixture which writes the log files, okay? All right, now you may ask, okay, you can define some data on a wiki page with 10 lines, 20 lines, maybe 100 lines. If you write 1,000 lines, you will really need some people to do this for you. So of course, you also want to test with some kind of real data, with, let's say, snapshots or parts of your live data. A first prerequisite to do this in our environment was that we have been choosing the same hardware for the test and for the dev environment that we had in prod. So actually, we didn't have like 20 nodes, but we took 3 of those machines from live and put them in our test environment, in our test cluster. This was the first thing that we did. And then we did some kind of random or biased sampling. So for example, we were running the tests in the test environment with a data snapshot, say, for 1 hour or of 1 day. And by doing so, our goal was to create some kind of feedback loop. So when you actually define test data manually, it's very hard to find out all those special cases that actually break things at the end, all right? And so then we just took these parts of the live data, and we found out all those in a way special, strange cases, and we added those cases to the manual data definition. And by doing so, we're actually increasing gradually our test coverage. So it's a kind of, it's a loop. It just, you do some kind of test data manually, then you do some thing with parts of the live data, and basically you're just getting better with each run, actually. Right, so to sum up this third part, one can say that using fitness, you can define CSV, Thrift, or real-world test data as the basis for the actual jobs and for the actual test runs. All right, so far about the data, but finally we want to run Hadoop jobs. So how do we do this with fitness? The first way to do it was called the Swiss Army knife. So there is something called a shell fixture. This shell fixture enables you to write any kind of arbitrary bash command into this wiki site, as you see here. What you do actually here is you're basically calling the Hadoop binary, the Hadoop command, and you first upload a file to HDFS, and then you run some kind of Hadoop job, all right? So this is the first thing that you can do. So you can basically misuse, or you can use fitness as an alternative bash interface. So you can just write any kind of bash commands directly on your fitness site, okay? So this works, but again, then Mr. Ackermann would have to be able to write bash. So it's not really optimal. But you can execute arbitrary shell commands, and the point is, we didn't write a lot of code for this fixture. This fixture is mainly just a wrapper around Apache commands exec command line. So we just pass on those commands to an existing library. Well, as I said, this is not the nicest way. Then we wrote a Hadoop fixture. As I said, this fixture is thought, or it's intended, to enable literally everybody to start and stop Hadoop runs and so on. And so we've already seen this fixture. I've shown it before. As I said, we start again with this command script, which tells us right now we start a series of Hadoop testing actions. And the rest of this test, as I said, I've already seen it before, is supposed to be written like a test story. So we say we upload this file to the HDFS, we start the job, we show the output, and we finally check if the number of output files is 3. So the idea, so now you don't have to know, for example, how to deal with the Hadoop shell command. This is basically hidden from you as a test author. And this is kind of the point about those fixtures. You hide complexity from the test authors. So when you write such a fixture class, by choosing the right method names, you can, in a way, define a good language via those Java method names. So you can just, in a way, you can listen to, let's say, Mr. Ackermann, see what he would say if you want to start some kind of job, and then just name the method accordingly, and then you have his language. And of course, internally, you can reuse other fixtures, because, for example, when you start this Hadoop job, internally, we reuse the shell fixture. But now this is a very crucial point, because this is the one of the core points about fitness, that you can really define your own test language, which really fits the needs of all big data application development participants. All right, but then we also wanted to be able to not only run a test with one Leopard 2's job, but with chains. And now there is one thing which is also common in the testing environment, that fitness also has suites, so you can group tests into suites, and those suites are exactly what we used to, in a way, simulate our MapReduce processing chains. So we did have some kind of workflow engine at 1&1, which was starting those jobs, but we really wanted to be able, for example, if you have a chain with, let's say, 10 MapReduce jobs, and you run this whole chain, and the first 9 are doing well, and the last one fails, you don't want to run the first 9 tests again if you want to test the 10th one, okay? And so this is why we use this, suite approach. And another good thing about this suite approach is that you can also add some kind of setup suite, which, for example, downloads the, in a way, latest artifact from your Maven repository, deploys your artifact, cleans the database, and so on, and you have a teardown suite which cleans up the whole mess that you have created during testing. But of course, still, you can run the tests individually, right? And so this was actually, it's a very simple built-in fixture, but it really did the job of our job and workflow control in our case. All right, so to sum up this fourth part, we could say that in our project, we used suites and fixtures to run and to control jobs and workflows. And now finally, the last thing that you want to do, you want to check if what you have done is right. So you need to be able to inspect the results. So how can you do this with fitness? Now there is one thing which comes along with fitness, which is called query tables. So now let's start from the very end of the processing chain. So we do all those Hadoop jobs, MapReduce jobs, and at the end we write some really precious KPI in our data warehouse, and you want to check in this data warehouse if the number is right. And with this kind of query table, you can basically execute any SQL command against any database, which you can access via JDBC. And in the next lines, you basically write what you would expect. So what happens now internally is then this query is being sent to the database. The result is being sent back, and it is compared against what you write here. And if the result is the same, all the numbers are green, and if there is one number which is different, it is being red. So this is basically what you do if you want to check, for example, your very final KPIs which you write into your data warehouse. But now when you have worked with Hive, you will know that Hive in combination with the Hive server also allows an access via JDBC, and you can also use this and, in a way, set up fitness to directly query Hive. And this is also a very nice thing, because then you can't only query your data warehouse with an RDBMS, but you can also, in a way, query your raw data by writing those Hive queries directly on your fitness page, right? So this is what fitness offers you to, in a way, query those variables. Well, but as I said, one other thing that is very, that was very special about our jobs is that we have all those strange binary intermediate formats. So, for example, we write intermediate formats results in the AFRO format. And for this purpose, we wrote a pick fixture. So you can now add. So again, you start and you say, right now, on this page, I want to execute pick commands. You start a pick console with some parameters. You want to MapReduce. Here is the jar which holds your fixtures. You have some other arguments. And then we want to load a certain AFRO file from HDFS into a certain alias. And then what you can do in the next lines, you can add like as many lines as you like. And each line is one statement of PicLatin. So you can basically add PicLatin directly to your fitness page and do some kind of processing. Here we first filter one column, and we then again filter the values of this column. And finally, we check if we have actually 35 matches in our result. So, yeah, and this is so. Yeah, so now you can basically write any kind of pick command directly on your fitness page. Of course, Mr. Ackermann does not necessarily speak pick, but maybe one of those guys who does write tests does speak pick. And the next thing is that you can also, in a way, yeah, add some kind of special Java method names, which kind of are being translated internally to pick commands. And this is what I will like to show you on the next slide. So this is like a snippet of the source code of this pick console that I was calling right here. And the first thing you should notice is that this pick console does extend the pick server. So if you've ever done something with pick, you will know this class. It's the internal main entry point for doing pick queries. And so by extending the pick server, or by this very simple extent, what we get is we can call each method from the pick server directly from our fixture, right? So we can, so basically what we do is you can reuse existing libraries, Java classes, and so on, and use them as a fixture, because basically every Java class is a fixture. And so by doing this simple extent, we can reuse all the methods from the pick server. And on top, we can add this, in a way, nice layer of test language. So by adding this method, load AFRO file using alias, you can now write on your fitness page, please load this AFRO file into the alias, which is kind of natural language. And internally, we translate this call to a PicLatin statement. And so this is now something that also Mr. Ackermann could do, because he would, or he might stand behind you in the test and tell you, could you please load this AFRO file into a certain alias, okay? And internally, you can translate it to pick. And I mean, of course, you can, in a way, it's of course, would not be a good idea to, in a way, reinvent pick or to paraphrase pick, but you can add method names which hide the pick complexity. All right, and now finally, the last thing, or the last experience that we made at in our projects is that you don't want to inspect the results only in a testing environment, but you also want to be able to run your test within different environments. So at our project, we had a dev environment, we had a testing environment, and we had a live environment. And so what you could do is you could set up one fitness server in like each environment, write the tests there, and run them there. But we didn't want to have this. We wanted to have all tests at one like central place. And so what we did is we had one like fitness master where all the tests for all projects go in, right? And so like in this fitness master, we have one kind of substructure where we have one area for each project. And then what we do is in each of our environments, so here we have the dev environment, here we have the testing environment, and finally we have the live environment, we set up a client. It's just another fitness server, which basically imports the tests from the central server. There is a built-in mechanism from fitness which allows you to do this. And then you can basically import all the, te- all those tests and run them like the same tests in like different environments. But now, of course, if you run the tests in the dev environment, you want to access the dev database. If you run them in the testing environment, you want to access the testing database, so you need some configuration. And now we also stored the configuration in the central server. So for each project, we store one config for like each environment. And again, we import this config. And so finally, what we have is we have in each of our environments, we have like a thin client, which is just a plain fitness server, which imports the tests from the central server and is being configured also from the central server. And so it's very easy to add, for example, new environments. So when we left one and one, they were thinking about adding some kind of pre-live environment. So we could serve this very easily by adding just one more fitness server and just adding one more config. And so we can basically scale in all dimensions of this test matrix. Right, so far about the story. Again, those are the main steps of the talk, and this is basically like the whole story. We first saw that Big Data Gray is different. We saw that fitness is a good addition for our use case. We can define test data, we can run jobs, and we can inspect the results with Big and Hive. But finally, the most important thing that we finally realized in our project was that now everybody is actually happy. And this, as Innovex, of course, is our motivation to make our customers happy finally. And I have to add one little advertisement section. If you want to know more about all this stuff, we also offer various trainings. And finally, I'm not the only Innovex guy here. If you happen to see one of those guys during the VM conference, there's also Stefan already sitting here. You can talk to them. First of all, they're very nice people. And second, they really know a lot about big data and about the stuff that I was just talking about. And thank you for questions.